night patch today, so I'm going to be a little scarce and let our wonderful honorary advisory board member, Tom Rogers, run this program today. If you don't know Tom, you really should. You may have seen him on CNBC or MSNBC because he's on both of them all the time. But Tom has extensive experience on Capitol Hill where he started earning his political chops. You should know him as, and I'm sure he's best known as, a brilliant media pioneer. He founded both CNBC and MSNBC when he headed up NBC Cable. So that's quite a background. He's also editor at large at Newsweek, and he's the executive chairman of the publicly traded company Engine Media. So with that, please welcome Tom Rogers.
Thank you, Patricia, and hope your eyes feeling better soon. We are going to talk today about the middle. Is it disappearing, or are the parties just ignoring it? And a whole bunch of additional questions which flow from all that. And who better to speak to it than the panel that has been put together today by Common Good? First, Matt Bennett, who has journeyed from the campaign trail to the White House and from the pages of the New York Times to appearances on Meet the Press and 60 Minutes. He's worked on both the presidential campaigns of Bill Clinton and served as deputy assistant to the president for intergovernmental affairs in the Clinton White House. We have Bill Galston with us, who writes the weekly Politics and Ideas column in the Wall Street Journal. He holds the Ezra Zilka Chair in the Brookings Institution's Governance Studies Program, where he serves as a senior fellow. He's been a participant in 6 presidential campaigns. He served as deputy assistant to President Clinton for domestic policy. He's the author of 10 books and more than 100 articles in the fields of political theory, public policy, and American politics. And Elaine has not joined us yet, but I will introduce her on the theory that she will be here soon. Fills out our troika of former Clinton White House participants, and no better group of players to talk about the whole issue of the political center than people out of the Clinton administration. Elaine is a senior fellow in the Governance Studies Program and director of the Center for Effective Public Management at Brookings. She's an author and lecturer in public policy at Harvard Kennedy School. She's been a member of the Democratic National Committee and the DNC's Rules Committee, and was in the Clinton administration as a senior policy advisor. I'm hearing something strange, but not sure where that's coming from. Okay. Why don't we get going, and hopefully Elaine will join us. We're going to do a round robin of questions for about 35 minutes or so, and then open it up to various other people. Let me just note a few people who have joined us here today who deserve to be noted. We have some honorary advisory board members of Common Good here. Former Congressman Jane Harman, Byron Wien is with us, Kay Kopovitz, and Silda Wall Spitzer are here, although I think Silda may be in a car and not able to join us completely. We also have a bunch of past speakers and hosts of this program, along with some notable VIPs. If they're not on yet, they will soon be joining: Frank Luntz, Rick Gries, the Honorable Gillian Sorensen, Jill Liskall, Sally Minard, the Honorable Amanda Burden, Ambassador Joseph Paulino, Liz Robbins, and Richard Solomon. And a few media people that are certainly worth calling out: Judith Miller, Susan Milligan, and Nancy Collins. So thanks everybody for joining us. We got quite a crew here for this discussion, and it's a very noteworthy one. Let me kick it off with this. There are, by a number of accounts, more independents now than at any time in recent history, as opposed to registered members of the Democratic or Republican parties. Yet most political analysts talk about a center that is disappearing in favor of politically polarized red and blue America with a smaller and smaller center. So how should we reconcile more independence than ever with a disappearing center? And Matt, why don't we start it off with you?
Great. Thank you, Tom. And Tricia, thanks for having me. And hello, everybody. In my day job now, I'm a co-founder and EVP at Third Way, a center-left think tank that Jane Harman was a founding co-chair of. And it's great to see you, Jane. I think I will challenge the premise of the question. I do not believe that the actual American electorate is defined by the ideological extremes. I think the discussion of politics in the media and on social media is overwhelmingly defined by the extremes, but actually the American electorate is not that extreme. As I'm sure Elaine and Bill will discuss in more detail, there was a very good survey by More in Common that made very clear that most voters define themselves as what More in Common calls as part of the exhausted middle. They are not ideologically extreme on the left or the right. And that is especially true if you look at the people who determine elections. Independent voters went with the winner in the last three federal elections, including the midterms in 2018. They went for Biden by 9 points, and they went for Trump in 2016. So there are swing voters, there are centrist voters out there. We did focus groups at Third Way with large collections of voters in Virginia who had voted for Joe Biden and then exactly 1 year later voted for Glenn Youngkin. I mean, those are swing voters. Those are centrist voters. Now, they differ in the reasons that they may have changed parties, you know, over the course of a year, but there's just no question that most voters are in the middle. And I'll just make one more point, which is despite the fact that all of the conversation in politics and in political media had been around the excitement around the most extreme candidates in the 2020 presidential primaries, and everyone was betting that Sanders or Warren was going to be the nominee, we ended up with Joe Biden, which is not surprising because the Democratic electorate is genuinely moderate. They tend very strongly towards moderates at the national level, as they did every time they've had to choose in the last 30 years, but also most recently in primary elections in the midterm. So I would argue that the electorate itself is actually pretty moderate.
All right. Bill, let me throw it over to you and just refine that thought a little bit. Is it that most voters are in the middle, or do we have a very significant slice of centrist voters in 10 swing states that most define presidential outcomes and the composition of the Senate? And while much of the country is polarized, heavily red or heavily blue, the center matters, but it's a small slice that matters in a small slice of the country.
Well, Tom, it's good to meet you. I think we haven't met before. And Patricia, I'll simply echo Matt in thanking you for inviting me to this illustrious program. I would make a couple of points. First of all, a lot of people call themselves independents who really aren't. So, if you look at the swath of people who call themselves independents, which is now around 40% of the electorate, at least it was the last time I checked, about a third of them are functional Democrats. About a third of them are functional Republicans. And then you have that slice in the middle of anywhere between 10 and 15% who are genuine independents. And you might infer from that that the center or the swing portion of the electorate is small. But that's not right. Because if you look at the voters who actually change their minds between one election and another, whose votes are not simply determined by party affiliation. You'll see overlapping groups of people who call themselves independents, people who call themselves moderates, people who live in the suburbs, and increasingly Hispanic Americans. There's been a lot of talk about the shift in the Hispanic electorate recently. I think that's real, not just accidental or if I'm still permitted to use this adjective, transitory. And I can explain that if anybody's interested. So when you add it all together, you have a substantial slice of the electorate that is prepared to shift, depending on the kind of appeal that it hears. And if you want proof of that, all you need to do is compare the 2016 presidential election, which Hillary Clinton lost with 48% of the vote, which was a plurality, to the 2020 election, where Joe Biden won with about 51.5% of the votes. And he scored double-digit improvements among moderates and independents and suburban voters, compared to an improvement about half that much among white working class voters, to whom he made a strenuous appeal based on his identity as working class Joe from Scranton, Pennsylvania. So it may be the case, and this is my second point, that the center is smaller than it was half a century ago, but it is also the case that our elections are closer than they were half a century ago. I'm not going to give you my political science talk on that, but if you put these two facts together, voters in the middle who are prepared to switch party, if not affiliations, at least partisan votes from one election to another based on arguments and candidates, are as important to the outcome of presidential and other elections as they ever have been.
Well, if you take that notion that the center is larger and more significant than it may be given credit for, you look at the last nine elections, I think there were a cumulative 1 billion votes cast and something like 51-48 Democrat to Republican when you put the scoreboard together. That suggests a very evenly split country. With the center dynamics that you're talking about, you would think that lends itself to compromise capability within the government in a much easier way than what we see, where compromise almost seems impossible. So how do we get from the center being that significant and that being that evenly split a country to such a polarized legislative process where compromise largely seems impossible?
Tom, let me just start by saying Elaine just called me. She is en route to the hospital with a granddaughter who has a broken arm. She's very sorry to miss. And Patricia, she sends her regards. She didn't have your phone number with her. So
thank you. So sorry to hear that.
Yeah. So Bill and I will hold down the fort. So I guess I'll just take a crack at that question, Tom, and then turn it to Bill. But I think there's a number of reasons. And again, this goes to Bill's kind of political science, but there's the great sorting out. We now live in places that are very red and very blue. People tend to live near others who agree with them. Combine that with radical gerrymandering, and what you get are congressional districts and even states that are very red and very blue, and very few places where being a moderate is rewarded politically. There are now maybe, I don't know, at most 40 congressional districts where that is something that you can run on and win. So I think that is reason number one. The other is, and it goes to a point that, part of a point that Ed made in the chat, which is, I would argue that we have one national party that is still fundamentally fairly moderate, led by a moderate president, and controlled by, for the most part, moderate impulses. There are plenty of radicals in the Democratic Party. We have an extraordinarily big tent. The House Democratic Caucus ranges from very, very radically far left people to, you know, people who are would be comfortable in the Republican Party of the 1980s. Having said that, if you look at what we actually do, if you look at the outcomes, for the most part, they are pretty moderate, whereas now you have a Republican Party that has become totally in the thrall of the Trump cult. They have lost their bearings, in my view, entirely. And so they've been radicalized, but not ideologically. They've been radicalized around a populist leader. And so it's very difficult to make an assessment about whether you can be a Republican centrist now because the party has been so thoroughly hijacked.
I wonder if there's another way to cut that, though, relative to the Democratic Party being more moderate. If Democrats generally think that driving economic issues is going to be a more winning hand than driving cultural issues, have they adopted stances on social issues, from policing to immigration to parents' rights in public schools, transgender rights, that are out of step with a majority of Americans? The defund the police rhetoric was probably the most striking example of that. While we have a war going on that defines good and evil, if you watch Tucker Carlson at night, who probably garners a larger news audience than anybody out there, you'd think that the biggest crisis facing America is teachers trying to indoctrinate elementary school kids on gender fluidity. And obviously there are a lot of people who buy that. So do the Democrats need to better understand the impact of cultural issues to be able to have a more defining reach to the center, or is economics the winning hand?
Well, you've touched on one of the big strategic debates within the Democratic Party. And I will give you my view, which is not the consensus view, because there is no consensus view on this question. My own view is that the Democratic Party has moved pretty sharply to the left on cultural issues, even while it has remained quite moderate on economic issues. And the cultural issues are having an enormous negative impact on the party's prospects. It will be a driving force in the November midterm elections, and it could also be the centerpiece of the 2024 presidential campaign. If you want to see the kind of damage these issues can do, you need look no farther than the gubernatorial election in Virginia about a year ago. The Virginia economy was in pretty good shape by national standards, and certainly given the impact of the pandemic. That wasn't, and Terry McAuliffe talked about all the businesses he had brought to Virginia as governor and promised to do it again. And he was certainly telling the truth about his record. It got him absolutely nowhere, right? Because all of the conversation was about schools and parental rights. And there are other parts of the country that are riveted by issues such as transgender rights, open borders, progressive policing, the elimination of bail requirements. I could go on and on and on. And unfortunately, these are issues that people can experience for themselves. They're not abstract arguments. They're not arguments that you need. They're not issues that you need to learn about through the media. If you're showing up hopping mad at a school board meeting, it's because of an experience or an idea or a belief that is very direct and close to you. So I think Democrats are going to have an increasingly hard time in national elections unless they unless they can find an honorable way of recentering the party's views and the perceptions of the party on cultural issues. And I could name you 10 people inside the Democratic Party who would give me a heated response.
Well, given that they haven't found their way on cultural issues, and despite a record on the economy that has some pretty good strong points to tout, inflation running as it is, and probably through the next 9 months of the year, likely to continue to run as it is, which gives them a very difficult time to be anything but on the defensive relative to the economy. How do Democrats with a bad economic hand and no cultural message that is resonating, how do they reach out to the center between now and Election Day?
That is a tough question, Tom, but I will do my best. Look, I think you're right. First of all, I agree with Bill 1,000% on everything he just said about the danger of culture issues for Democrats. And so starting with the economy, I think they have to pray that inflation comes down a little. I don't think that people on this call think it's gonna very much. And so what they're gonna have to do is come up with a very simple set of things that they can articulate about what Democrats are trying to do to help people deal with the economy. Now, it is, while inflation is raging, it is also, of course, true that we've had an enormous boom, that jobs are plentiful. And so they do need to point to that, but they also have to say, and I'm doing the following three things to help with the rising costs of gas and food. And there are things that they can talk about. There are things that Biden has done. There are things that Biden is preparing to do to help with healthcare costs and other things, which we can get into if you like. But I do think they need to be very clear and simple and stick to a very small number of things that they continue to point to. On the culture war questions, though, I think Third Way did a major retrospective on the 2020 election, because in that election, we lost a net of 14 House seats. 12 of them were House freshmen on the same ballot that Joe Biden won the presidency. That is not supposed to happen. And the reason it happened is because those freshmen were attacked as being in league with the far left, even though they weren't. It was just a tissue of lies being told about them, but it were very effective lies. For the most part, they were about to fund the police in 2020. Next time it could be, as Bill said, in Virginia, it was schools. Next time it could be borders, it could be transgender, it could be a number of things. We actually started a super PAC called Shield PAC to help shield Democrats from these attacks, because no one else is doing it. The party aligned groups, House Majority PAC and the DCCC and others, don't do that. All they do is attack Republicans. They don't respond when Republican attacks land as they did in 2020. And we thought that was a serious problem.
Well, let me throw out another possibility for attracting the center and see if you guys believe it has any life to it. The news backdrop that has been with us for the last month or so, and will probably unfortunately continue for a while longer, is the war in Ukraine, the pitting of Putin against the interests of the West, a autocratic dictator being stood up by a heroic Ukrainian president, backed by the United States and the West. Hard to find a better backdrop for the forces of democracy against the forces of autocracy to keep that notion fresh in people's mind. And we seem to have a Republican Party that is bent on misinformation, with many of the candidates that will probably sweep into victory if the Republicans are as successful as many of the polls suggest they will be in the House, that we will have many that adhere to the big lie notion. And if 2010, 2012 are any guide here, where you had over 60 Republicans sweep in the first midterm of the Obama years. And even though Obama regained his popularity in 2012, the Democrats only regained about eight of those 60 seats in 2012. And so that would suggest potentially that the Republicans would hold control with big lie proponents in the majority in 2024. And the prospect of handing Donald Trump, if he runs again, the election, whether he wins it or not, and autocracy winning out against democracy could well play out. Is that too much of a backseat issue for centrists who will be the decision makers here in 2022 and 2024 to be able to win out against bad economic argument and no good cultural war argument?
Let me take a crack at that one, Tom, but I bet Matt has something to say about it too. First of all, in in your final sentence, as you were teeing up the question, you said 2022 and 2024, and I'd like to distinguish very sharply between them. Right, I am skeptical that even if Frank Luntz were running the Democratic Party's message, that he could avert a change of control, party control in Congress. I just think that if you combine history with today's realities, that is or would be an extremely heavy lift. And I can't even imagine what odds I'd have to be given to take the Democratic side in 2022. But of course, Matt and I both endured two of the largest congressional routs in history, one in 1994, when we were both in the Clinton administration, and Clinton came back to regain his equilibrium and regain and hold the presidency by 8 percentage points. And, Obama's loss in 2010 was even bigger, something like 63 seats. And, he was really in trouble if you just looked at presidential job approval for all of 2011 and even the first few months of 2012. And then when people began comparing him not to perfection, but to the alternative, things looked better. Having said that, I believe that President Biden would be very ill-advised to bet on some sort of natural cycle that will move him to the kinds of recovery victories that Bill Clinton and Barack Obama enjoyed. I think in order to get a better result, he is going to have to change the central focus of American politics. And here is where your question, I think, comes in. I'd put it this way. This is my 1 minute history of the past 80 years of American foreign policy. 1941, Japanese attack, Hitler declares war on the United States. We have two enemies, one in the East, one in the West. After World War II, we discovered that we had one enemy, and we fought that enemy for more than four decades and succeeded. After that, we thought we had no enemies. It was really great while it lasted, as I'm sure Matt will attest. And now we're back to two enemies, one in the East, one in the West. We are back structurally to where we were at the beginning of World War II. And if you combine that fact with the global struggle between democracy and autocracy, I think President Biden has a real opportunity to become the kind of respecter, a kind of responder to unexpected conflict that Harry Truman was. He has a chance to craft and lead a new way of thinking about America in the world and drawing the consequences for the policies that we need to pursue at home in order to measure up to these responsibilities. I could go into more detail, but that's my grand theory of everything. I think that one reason we're having debates about cultural issues is that it's been a long time since we've had a serious debate about the big picture of America and the world. And if the president could consistently focus on that between November of 2022 and 2024, I think that he would have his best possible chance of averting the catastrophic outcome that you just sketched in your question.
Well, I agree that's there to be grabbed, and bringing that back home to domestic politics and democracy versus autocracy, there's dots there to be connected. On your foreign policy analogy, I'd suggest that the United States hasn't won a war since World War II. We didn't win Korea, we didn't win Vietnam, we haven't won Iraq, we didn't win Afghanistan. Here's a war that we aren't directly fighting, but I'd suggest we have to win. And do you think that that can be a defining election issue, Matt?
It's very hard to see how. In the modern era, foreign policy and national security has been a defining election issue twice, in 2002 and in 2004. And that's basically it. Jane may disagree, but I think it would be very surprising if national security kind of as its own thing was a dominant issue in the campaign. I agree with Bill that Biden has the opportunity to articulate a vision of America's place in the world as a result of what is happening now. And I think we may be experiencing a massive realignment in the post-war kind of order. We may be talking about needing to change everything in the way that the world relates to one another economically and diplomatically. But I don't think people are going to vote on that. I think what he can say is, we're in a competition with China, which we need to win. We are going to, you know, work with our allies to, we're going to lead the world in new technologies like clean energy, and we can win that race. And talk about the opportunities that we could face as a result of the kind of realignment. But I don't think the facts, unless we get into some sort of unimaginable shooting war, I doubt that that'll be a dominant election issue.
Well, if I could just add a point here, I find it remarkable in this era of polarized politics how relatively close together the rank and file members of the two political parties are. You know, not only on broad questions about Ukraine, like who's the aggressor and who has been wronged, but also almost point for point what the United States should do in response and what it shouldn't do. I won't take a lot of time now going down that list, but it's been a long time since I have seen such agreement between the rank and file members of the political parties on an issue of such significance. And one reason I hope that the president adopts the path that I'm suggesting is that it is an era, it is an issue which could pull against the extraordinary polarization and embitterment of American politics that's occurred. This, I'm trying to be realistic here. It may be pie in the sky, but I think it's a better shot at changing not only the center of American politics, but also the tone of American politics than continuing to discuss the questions that we have been discussing so long and so futilely.
Well, all good points. And for somebody to weigh in who has more political experience than any of us here, former Congresswoman Jane Harman. Jane, over to you for a question.
Well, thank you, Tom, and thanks everybody, and to Bill, and sadly to Elaine in absentia, and to Matt, thanks for the memories over the many years. By the way, my number one son is now a proud member of, excuse me, I am now fully recovered from COVID, is now proudly a member of the Third Way Board, so there. I do have some observations that are a little different from the conversation, but I'll say them quickly, and I do have one question. I was elected for the first time in 92, the same year as Bill Clinton. My politics were the same as Bill Clinton. As it turned out, through reapportionment, I ended up in a lean Republican district which I first thought was a catastrophe because Maureen Reagan was one of the people in running on the Republican side, but she lost. And the driving issue, folks, wasn't centrist economic policies, it was choice. So this was an election with a combination of someone in the center plus someone who was pro-choice. When Maureen Reagan lost, her support system came over and volunteered to be Republicans for Harmon. So that was amazing. I then survived a near-death experience in 1994 when most of the women, especially women elected to open seats as I was in 92, lost. I survived because Brian Frank, my son, came and sat with his mommy all night while the votes were counted. I survived because despite the fact that I was down 250 votes on election night, there were 10,000 uncounted absentee votes. And it had been my idea, guess what, folks, that we should mail to absentee voters. And so it was one of the first mailers by a Democrat to absentee voters. And I won by a rousing 811 votes out of 225,000 votes. So, you know, I've actually seen this movie and I should probably be embalmed and be in a museum someplace. Maybe I am embalmed in a museum, but I survived COVID. So back to this, my observation is a little bit different. I agree that the center is much bigger than we think it is. I agree that both parties actually have one, but I disagree that people in the center, like me and like all of you, or most of you, I think most of you, have much gravitas in politics now. I don't know what will change that. And here's my theory of the case. I think that the business model of Congress, no one really mentioned this, is totally broken. It used to be, we'll come together in the center and we'll solve the hard problems. America first, party second. That used to be it. Of course, that was already falling apart when I was elected in 92. That is no longer it. The it is scorched earth. We will not come together in the center. We will vote on a party line basis. Of course, there are a few exceptions. And the reason we will do it that way is because we want to be in the majority, and we won't be in the majority unless we stick together. And so what happens is those who come together to try to solve the problem, the bipartisans, are punished. And they're the ones who are primaried, which is a verb that I don't think existed a few years ago. And so my question to the crowd is, am I right? Is the business model of Congress a driver of the disintegration of the center or the attraction of the center to influence elections?
Tom, you want me to take that? Or?
Yeah, please.
So yes, without question, I think you're absolutely right that this is a huge problem. Of course, you saw this firsthand when Gingrich came to town and started us down this path, where he told his members, don't stay in Washington, don't socialize with Democrats, don't have your families come to Washington, don't get to know them as people. You are in a permanent campaign and you're out to kill them. And your only job is to retain or regain the majority. And that has taken deep, deep root. Now it's been overlaid by intense partisan vitriol already. After January 6th, that went up by 100x, because there were many Democrats who believed that Republicans either did not care about their physical safety, that they thought that they would be hurt or killed by supporters of their political opponents, and that they didn't care at all about the kind of center pole of American democracy. And they had pretty good reason to think that. So I think the level of partisan vitriol, which Bill and I thought was pretty bad when Tom DeLay was running Congress, is incomparably worse. And I agree totally, Jane, that the business model is broken. And I don't really have a solution for how to fix it.
Bill, any view on that?
I agree with Matt. And I would simply say that it's not just a matter of boundary drawing. The number of deeply blue states has increased over the past four decades. the number of deeply red states has increased, and the number of true swing states over the past 60 years, if you look at close elections, has declined from 20 to just 8 in the most recent presidential election. And the, you know, this polarization of the states has nothing to do with boundaries. It has everything to do with the fact that polarization makes living cheek by jowl by with people who disagree with you much more unpleasant than it used to be. And so a lot of conservatives are leaving California for Idaho, just to give one small example. And that sort of assortive mating at the national level is making the problem worse.
Well, while we're on that point, let me ask you about Texas, because I'm not sure Texas makes it into your eight, but people have been talking about Texas going purple and ultimately blue for a long time. The comment you made earlier about the Hispanic vote being somewhat disappointing to Democrats in terms of one of the key demographic issues that they were looking that were going to swing Texas that way. Beto looks like in the most recent polls, he's running neck and neck there for governor. That doesn't mean a whole lot relative to the ultimate outcome. But obviously, if Texas went blue, it would totally change the electoral map and make a whole lot of other swing states that are now critical far less important in terms of national electoral college outcome. Do you see any prospect for that anytime soon?
No. And it is fool's gold for Democrats. Do not invest in Texas. I'm begging you. It is not going to happen. It's getting worse, not better. As Bill noted earlier, Hispanics, particularly in South Texas near the border, surged in their turnout and just annihilated Democrats in Texas. That state is not turning purple anytime soon. I wish with all my heart that it would, but I don't think it will. And I think one of the things that we can, the Democrats at least, can thank the Biden campaign for is not taking the bait in Texas and in Florida, and instead investing in the blue wall, Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and thereby winning an election that they could have fumbled away had they misdirected resources.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree with Matt. And I'm glad that he added Texas into the equation, rather Florida into the equation, because what's happening in Florida is really quite discouraging. The registration numbers, party registration numbers, are shifting strongly in the Republicans' favor. And I would be very surprised if Democrats won a single statewide election this November. I say that with no joy, you know, because if Texas is still out of reach and Florida is moving out of reach, then the margin for error for Democratic presidential candidates, even with the best strategy, is distressingly narrow. And the blue wall, which has never been rock solid, had better be reinforced. And we all know how close to defeat Biden came in Georgia and Arizona. Not that winning those two states was anything less than, I'd say, a real campaigning success of organizing, a success of focus. But the terrain is difficult, and it's not getting easier at the national level. It's my summary judgment.
Ed Goodstick, I think you have a question. You there? Ed, no? How about Rich Gordon? Question?
Tom, thank you. I appreciate this. This has really been great. Bill, Matt, great to see you again. Hope you guys are doing well. Look, moderates in the Senate are leaving in droves over the years. You know, the Bies, the Liebermans, the Corkers, they're all gone. My question is, you know, you have the Bullocks and the Bredesens who couldn't do it. It doesn't seem like moderates are getting elected to the Senate anymore. My question for you guys is, you know, what does this mean for the Senate going forward, assuming we lose control next time? But what does it mean for the Senate going forward? And what does it mean for the type of people who are being attracted to run for these type of offices and how that plays out over a long period of time?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think, again, I'm a partisan, so take it with a grain of salt. But I do think that there remain a number of Senate Democrats who could be fairly characterized as moderate. And I think anyone with any hope of winning a Senate race is moderate. If we're going to somehow win the Pennsylvania Senate race, I think it's a long shot. Our only hope is if Connor Lamb wins that primary. I mean, John Fetterman is not going to be a senator. Like, that is not going to happen. And so while there are, I mean, obviously Bernie Sanders is a senator, there are some far left senators. For the most part, there's still 15 or 20 Senate Democrats who are relatively moderate, but they are an endangered species. I mean, we could lose Michael Bennett this cycle. That is a real live possibility. And I would argue Catherine Cortez Masto is reasonably moderate. We could lose her, Maggie Hassan. They are in tough races because, as my colleague Jim Kessler says, the moderates have the beachfront property, and when the wave comes, they're the ones who get swept away. And so there is a danger of the Senate becoming even more polarized. Now, the problem on the other side is that you are, if you look at the Republican primaries for Senate, all of them are engaged in an astonishing race to the bottom. I mean, it is unlike anything I've ever seen. I mean, the most obvious example is Ohio, where you have J.D. Vance and Josh Mandel, both of whom presumably know better, just becoming absolute caricatures of Trump cultists. And that's happening all over the place. And a bunch of those people are going to be senators. So McConnell's going to have a much more radicalized Senate Republican conference. And it's possible that the Democratic conference will be either smaller or slightly more radical as well.
But when you say they're going to be senators, it seems to discount everything you're saying about the center, that, you know, these are people that live, their politics is owning the libs, swearing allegiance to Donald Trump, and going to the most extreme places on culture issues. That seems like a formula that is not one to attract the center. So it seems to me when you think that, you know, that's a formula for success, it really discounts the importance of the center.
Bill, you want to take that?
Go ahead, Bill.
I think that's directed to you, Matt.
Oh, well, I'll be happy to answer very quickly. Look, I think that's basically right, but the problem is, it's the point that Bill made earlier, which is that the Senate structurally just advantages small states with very radicalized populations. So if you're going to win in Idaho, you better be really radical.
But Ohio is not that.
Ohio is not, but Ohio has become a very, very red state. I mean, it used to be a swing state. It is no longer. Democrats, I mean, occasionally we could get a win like with Sherrod Brown, but for the most part, Democrats have very little hope of winning Ohio. It was not really contested in the presidential election last time, and I don't think it will be in 2024. So what you're seeing is there are a very small number of states where being a moderate can be useful. I would argue places that are real swing states like New Hampshire. Hassan has she has a decent chance of winning. She could lose, but she has a chance of winning because that state is controlled by the moderates. And the question is, if you're looking at the electorate as a whole, I think we're right that the center still is the dominant force in politics. But if you're looking at it divided up by the Electoral College or by the US Senate, then the ideologues do have more control, especially in the red states.
Let me just drop.
I'm sorry, go ahead, Bill.
No, it's okay. I just want to drop, you know, a small gloomy footnote to what Matt just said. I'm paying close attention to the Republican primary in North Carolina. And there you have a, you know, who would have been 20 years ago, 10 years ago, maybe even 6 years ago, you know, a highly qualified candidate, the former Republican governor of the state. He would immediately join whatever common sense caucus formed in the center of the United States. And his prospects appear to be fading in the face of the Trump-endorsed candidate, which brings up, I think, a larger point about the current state of the party competition, and that is Donald Trump is not fading away, contrary to the expectations of a lot of people who've read a lot of American history. Trump is defying that history with the kind of preponderant influence that he continues to have within his party. And I think as long as he's on the scene, it's going to be hard for the forces of moderation in his own party to gain much traction.
I agree with that. Gillian Sorensen, you have a question?
Yes, thank you. So interesting, all of this, and thank you all for being here. We all remember when there was a stronger center in both parties. They met somewhere in the middle, working across the aisle, and compromising to get something done was not a sin. That, to me, was a healthy situation for our political parties. And that seems to have vanished. I'm a Democrat, but I say that as one who grew up in a family with a father who was a moderate Republican, who held office, who ran for office, who supported family planning, I might add. He was comfortable in the Republican Party, but in today's Republican Party, there would be no room for him at all. And looking long ahead, that's a serious problem for our country. It's important, it's necessary for us to have two strong, healthy parties. So my question is, even for Democrats, what can we do to see that there are responsible Republicans coming up? Is there any way we should reach across and encourage them? And even going back early in terms of education in this country, I understand that in many schools, civics has been eliminated. So students are coming up who have no idea about the political parties, about the three branches of Congress, about what it means to vote and why it matters. So I guess I'm looking for some answers about what regular people can do to help two healthy parties thrive.
Well, you rang a lot of bells for me, Gillian, as you were talking. And let me give you partial answers to both of the issues that you raised. About 20 years ago, I was so worried about the state of civic education in the United States that I founded a research center devoted to the civic and political life of young people. And we focused very heavily on the public schools as venues for improved civic education. We put out a document called the Civic Mission of Public Schools. We put together a huge multi-state coalition, and under the leadership of a young man by the name of Peter Levine, they did everything right, and we made very little progress. The public schools, for reasons that if I had a lot of time, I would try to explain to you, are not really very eager to teach civics anymore, largely because they haven't figured out how to teach it without getting embroiled in political arguments that superintendents hate, that school boards hate, etc. You're absolutely right. And there are groups that are taking another crack at the issue. If you'll send me your email, I'll direct you to some of them, because they may be able to do a better job than we were able to do. As for your point about the way things used to be, you mentioned, I believe it was your father who is a moderate Republican, but also a pro-choice. If I understand it, in favor of family planning. Well, in the old days, about a third of the Democratic Party was pro-life. Democrats have systematically purged pro-life candidates and even incumbents. I could give you some example of that. So that I do not believe that there is a single pro-life Democrat, with possible exception of Henry Cuellar, left in the entire Democratic caucus. So both sides on social and cultural issues have moved away from big tent strategies. And we now have, sadly, a pro-life party and a pro-choice party, which is doing the country no good and which has helped precipitate what I'm afraid is going to be a judicial catastrophe sometime later this summer. So, you know, that's not an answer to what can we do, but it is a suggestion that I think the Democratic Party, as well as the Republican Party, is going to have to do a better job of including difference in its ranks.
Oh, you mentioned a judicial tragedy. Do you think the Supreme Court overruling Roe v. Wade is a galvanizing enough broad cultural issue that the center could be motivated toward the Democratic Party in ways that it might not otherwise be?
I'm just going to say one sentence about that and then kick it over to Matt, who's probably a little closer to the congressional side than I am. I think it will be a galvanizing event. Whether it will be big enough, whether the dismay and discontent will translate into a real mobilization of voters in the center and center left, I think it might, but I'm really not sure. That's my most honest answer.
Yeah, I would say that the decision is likely to come at the end of June or very early July. And I think we could have a summer that's similar to 2020. I think there could be enormous anger and, marches in the streets. Hopefully it won't devolve into violence again, that didn't devolve into violence. It was the Floyd murder marches were hijacked by violent people. But I think the risk politically, it's possible that it's a galvanizing moment for Democrats, but I think there's also a risk that you will see the left go to the barricades in ways that are very off-putting to voters who are not fully with us on the questions of choice versus life. And especially Hispanic voters. It could be very off-putting to a lot of Hispanic voters who tend to be either Catholic or evangelical, and that could be a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Could I add one thing there, please? Because I mentioned that was the motivating issue in 1992. Anita Hill, Clarence Thomas, remember all that?
Sure.
It really was. Republican women really care about choice, and it depends how this is handled. I think the likelihood is that the Supreme Court overrules or at least, basically emasculates, effeminizes Roe v. Wade. And I think if it's handled right, Republican women can lash up with Democrats, and it will be an issue that pulls the center together. So I think it's a big deal. I just wanted to put one other one out there that we haven't even touched, which I think is a catastrophe for Democrats, and that's immigration. I don't think we have a good answer.
Let me go to Kay Kopovitz for a question. Kay?
Yes, Tom, thank you. Just going back to the gerrymandering of districts for a moment, which was touched on only early in the beginning. Matt, I'm sort of wondering, my impression from press and reading the press is that the Republicans have always been a lot better at it than the Democrats have been. But it seems to me after 2020, the Democrats really did pay more attention to it. And there seems to be a little bit more balance in states where more House districts might be favorable to Democrats than in the past. Has that been, in your view, more of an equal division? I know there's some still in the courts to be decided, but it seems to me in looking at it, it is, there's been a little bit more equal assignment from maybe different states that are red states, blue states, perhaps. But what's your opinion about that? And are there openings there?
Yes. So that there's two ways that you have to think about redistricting and which party is up or down in redistricting. On the one hand, you're absolutely right. Democrats emerged from the redistricting process much, much stronger than anybody anticipated that we would, largely because big blue states, mostly New York and Illinois, were vicious in their gerrymandering. And cut Republican districts down as much as they possibly could. Now, the red states were pretty vicious, too. You can ask soon-to-be former Congressman Jim Cooper, whose district disappeared, and many others. But in the end, unless the DeSantis map in Florida holds, which was out today, and if that holds, we're going to be -4 rather than basically even. Democrats did better than expected because we were equally aggressive about gerrymandering this time, unlike last time. Having said that, two points to make. One is Republicans are just murdering us when it comes to electing state legislatures. Yes. And that is the most fundamental thing to do. You have to control the state legislatures. Just to give you some sense of it, Republicans control both houses of the state legislature in all 10 presidential swing states. That it's just a nightmare. And remember that they set their own boundaries as well. So they are locking in Republican control of state legislatures all over the country for at least another 10 years. And so ultimately, we did better than expected, but we started from a baseline that was very bad. The 2010 redistricting was super bad for Democrats. That was where we started, and it wasn't as bad again as we thought, but it's still pretty bad.
I'll just add on that point that I believe that the huge increase in Republican count in the House that will result from 2022 with a majority of big lie adherents that will carry over in all likelihood to 2024, given the vast majority they're going to have. With people who I think will be committed to trying to make sure that a legitimate electoral college count is not upheld and to throw it into the House of Representatives. My count from gerrymandering is that state by state delegation count, if something is thrown into the House of Representatives, has only been hardened by gerrymandering, even if the overall count comes out neutral, which is a troubling thing. Let me go to Ralph. You have a question? Ralph Dawson?
Yes, I do. First of all, thank you all for a very enlightening discussion. And I'm sitting here thinking to myself that the Republicans are very effective at successfully distorting our positions, just as they've done, for example, with respect to defunding the police. That is hardly a predominant position in the Democratic Party at all. So as I look at where we're at, I say to myself that we're in a situation here now where in many respects, the big issue is between democracy and autocracy. And we're in a situation where we stand for democracy and the leader of the other party is for autocracy. Shouldn't we try to label that party as an autocratic party?
Bill?
Well, as I mentioned in answer to a different question earlier in this conversation, I do think that that theme could be a thread that brings together the domestic political contest and the global political contest, and they could easily be mutually reinforcing. And we just have to be very careful not to drive away anti-Trump Republicans who could be for us if they think that we would provide a welcoming atmosphere for them. So the trick is to distinguish between a Democratic Party and an autocratic party without labeling all Republicans as autocrats, because many of them that I know will take great offense if they think that that's what we think of them when they've done nothing to deserve that label.
I think many of those people have the same fears about Trump that we have.
That is true.
Can Absolutely. I just make one point about that, Ralph? I couldn't agree more with both you and Bill. I do believe that the leadership of the Republican Party is autocratic, and one need only look at what they're doing to Liz Cheney, who is a very, very conservative member of Congress. I disagree with Liz Cheney on every single thing other than democracy, and yet she is being driven out, perhaps out of Congress, certainly out of the leadership, because she refuses to bend the knee to the autocrat. So I think the leadership of the party absolutely matches your description, Ralph. And I think Bill's right. We have to be careful about how we characterize that. And I put in the chat a link to a thing that we did about what that is meaning in real terms about how they're going to try to steal the election in ways that look quite different than they did in 2020.
I think we have time for one last quick question. Jill Iskol, you have a quick question for us? You're on mute, Jill.
Yeah, I'm on mute now. I agree with everybody. This has been a very, very important discussion, but I'd like to ask that given all of these realities, how are we going to win? And I do want to say something that gives a little light in the tunnel. Bill, by the way, do you remember the days of the DLC when we talked about the Socialist Republic of New York, when we were talking about the left wing of the party?
It's hard to forget those days. Some of the best days of my life.
Me too. Anyway, say hi to Elaine for me. But
we'll do.
I want to throw in a little something. I truly believe that there is something percolating from the ground up among and within the Democratic Party. There are grassroots groups now that are ignoring all this negative noise. And what they're spending their time on is educating people at grassroots levels who are our constituents and making sure that they understand the significance of this, what's going on, and that they get out and vote. One of the organizations, the umbrella organization, is Onward Together. Some of you may know it. Hillary Clinton launched it. And some of the groups are so important to get involved with: the Color of Change, I Vote, Indivisible, Living United for Change in Arizona, and so on. I urge you all to tell people to get involved with these grassroots organizations that are focusing on just what we were talking about: the states, local level politics, as well as national. So I hope that casts a little bit of a positive note on what, you know, we all need, because the backdrop of our lives is just really terrible right now. And we have to have hope. So that's it. No question, just responses.
Very good. Patricia, I know you like to run a tight ship here in terms of timing. Is that a wrap?
Okay, let's, I want to thank you so much. Unless you've got a quick response to that, that's a pretty interesting comment.
I know you wanted to mention a couple of upcoming events before everybody goes. Wednesday, May 25th, you have Suzanne Nozzle, the chief executive of PEN America, coming to discuss cancel culture and free speech. And I think on a date yet to be determined, Jonathan Greenblatt, the head of the Anti-Defamation League, is coming to discuss hate and extremism, all of which flows from this discussion today. I thought it was...
But I want to thank you so much for putting this, for leading on this, Tom. This is really, you guys have really outlined the difficulties for the center voter who has been left behind, I think, in the Democratic Party and even more so in the Republican Party. So thank you, Matt and Bill, so much. It's great to have you. I'm sorry we missed Elaine. But I hope we can get you back again. And Tom, you did great. Thank you so much for rolling with this. We're always pleased to have such a wonderful group today. So thank you so much. I hope we'll see you in a couple of weeks when we talk about hate and extremism, and then our cancel culture conversation.